a speeding bullet. More powerful than a locomotive. Able to leap tall buildings at a single bound.
Look, up in the sky. It's a bird.
It's a plane.
It's Superman. Yes, it's Superman. Strange visitor from another planet who came to Earth with powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men. Superman, who can change the course of mighty rivers, bend steel in his bare hands, and who, disguised as Clark Kent, mild-mannered reporter for a great metropolitan newspaper, fights a never-ending battle for truth, justice, and the American way. And now, another exciting episode in the adventures of Superman.
The introduction for the television series for the Adventures of Superman, which went on television on September 19th, 1952, for the first time. Superman was created in Cleveland, my hometown. It was created by Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster. Most of it was done in Jerry's house in Glenville. We're going to go down there in a little while. The announcer said to be ready for an exciting adventure of Superman. Every episode was exciting to a 6, 7, 8-year-old boy in Cleveland watching TV. We watched it in black and white on a little colored TV set. We couldn't wait for Superman to come on. Superman was disguised as a mild-mannered reporter by the name of Clark Kent. We all know Clark Kent, the hat, the glasses, the suit. He was never at the same place that Superman was, even though Lois and Jimmy were always there wondering where Clark was. But Clark was always fighting, as the announcer said, for truth, justice, and the American way. The name Clark Kent was selected by Jerry and Joe. Clark came from Clark Gable, who was born about 50 miles south of here in Cadiz, Ohio. He grew up 15 miles southeast of here in Ravenna, Ohio. Kent came from another actor's name, Ken Taylor. Kent was born in Nashua, Iowa, about 30 miles from the place where George Reeves, who played Superman on television, was born. So they put the two names together. Superman first appeared, a commercial entity, on March 1st, 1938, DC Comics. The check was made out in the amount of $412 to Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster. That was the same day that the contract was signed when Superman first became a commercial character. Then DC Comics issued in 1938 on June 1st, the first Superman comic book. That is the official birthday of Superman. I was born about the length of a football field north of the house where Superman was created, at Glenville Hospital, on March 1st, 1949. 11 years to the day after Superman was created. Scientists are now conducting neutron activation analysis tests to determine whether or not Superman and I are related. And when the results are made known, you'll be the first to hear about them. Yeah, the first Superman comic book was sold in the year 2014 for $3.2 million. That was exactly 100 years after George Reeves, Jerry Siegel, and Joe Shuster were born. They were all born in 1914. The book sold for $3.2 million. I have a copy of the May 1st, 1945 issue of Superman. When the first issue came out in 1938, Hitler had not yet invaded Europe. When this issue was released, Hitler was just defeated and Germany was surrounded by the Allied forces and Europe was set free. After Superman became a commercial character in the comic books, on February 12, 1940, Superman went on the radio. He was broadcast at 5 o'clock, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. That's when Dad came home from working in the factories for the war. And the family was having dinner. Superman occupied the radio waves and he was a big hit. Such a big hit that in 1943, he went on every night, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday at 5 o'clock. And his show was expanded from 15 minutes to a half hour. The country just loved Superman. And Superman stayed on the radio until my second birthday, March 1st, 1951, when he was taken off the radio for the purpose of making Superman feature films for the theater that summer and that fall. 13 episodes were shot, but they never made it to the theater. For reasons unknown, it was withheld. Superman was on television from September 19, 1952 until April 28, 1958. They took Superman off TV, but they were going to bring him back on TV. But it never happened. George Reeves died the following year. All of the episodes of Superman were shot in color, but for the first 3 years, they were only shown in black and white. For the next 4 years, they were shown in color, but nobody had a color TV set, so nobody knew that they were anything but black and white. Now I want to take you to the house where Superman was born, in the old neighborhood where I was born, just east of East 105th Street, at 10622 Kimberly Avenue. And we're going to see the house where Jerry Siegel lived. It's a national landmark now, where Superman came to life. I'm going to fly down there. Let's go. I'm standing in front of the house at 10622 Kimberly Avenue, where Superman was born. He was born up on the third floor behind me in the bedroom of Jerry Siegel. It's a pretty historic neighborhood here where I'm at. Jesse Owens was born about a mile behind me to the south. And just two blocks from that is where Margaret Hamilton, the actress who played the witch in The Wizard of Oz, one of the most identifiable characters on the planet. That's where she was born and raised. Jim Backus, who played the father of James Dean in Rebel Without a Cause, and who played on Gilligan's Island and Mr. Magoo, he was born about 3 miles north of me. I'm holding in my hand the Superman comic book from May 1945. It was printed in April of 45. And at that time, we know that Hitler was pretty much at the end of his Third Reich. The Russians were closing in from the east, the Allied forces from the west, they were closing in on Berlin, and the war in Europe was about to come to an end in May of 1945. I hold this in my hand, this printed comic book of Superman that was created in this house, and this one was printed when all of that history was happening in the world. It's humbling thought to be able to reach back and touch that history right here in Cleveland, Ohio. Let's take a look at that knife fight between James Dean in The Rebel Without a Cause and Corey Allen, who played Buzz Gunderson.
What? I don't want any trouble.
The blade game, huh, Buzz?
Only punks fought with knives.
Well, who's fighting?
Not fighting. It's examination time, man. It's a crazy game. Yeah, somebody get him a knife.
Jim? Hey, boy.
Give it to him.
No.
Come on, get him a knife.
Pick it up.
I don't want any trouble.
Pick it up!
Pick it up.
Now, you understand the action. Now, there's no sticking. Crunch.
Just a little jabbing, that's all.
What's the matter? What's the matter? What's the matter? Well, what are you waiting on, Toriador? I thought you wanted a little action.
Well, now, you crunch chicken.
Don't
you
call me that!
Oh! Hey, Toro! Hey, Toro! Oh!
Hey! Now you cut off a button and you get to join the club. Oh, that's close. Okay, same place.
Go ahead.
Hey, look out, Buzz, he's got a chain.
What is it?
Trouble.
Are you satisfied? Do you want some more?
Let's split, Buzz.
Dean's big fight scene between him and Buzz Gunnarsson. The actor Corey Allen was born in the same hospital I was born in, right through those trees. He lived about three blocks southwest of where I'm standing right now, which is to my left. Corey Allen was born the same month, that is June 1934, that Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster graduated from Glenville High School. Was born. His father was an accountant for the Mayfield Road organized crime family, and they eventually moved to Las Vegas. His father was Carl Cohen, who punched Frank Sinatra in the mouth and knocked out his two front teeth on September 11, 1967. That's because Howard Hughes, the owner of the Sands Hotel and Casino, cut off Sinatra's credit. Sinatra was in debt to the Sands at over $200,000, and Sinatra was often drunk. So he walked into the restaurant where Carl Cohen was eating breakfast one morning, flipped over the table, and got the breakfast all over Carl Cohen. Carl got up, punched Sinatra in the mouth, knocked out his two front teeth. Jerry had to walk down Kimberly Avenue to Parkwood Drive and head south to get to high school, and to walk past Joe's house. Joe and his family moved from Canada into the neighborhood, but far enough away from Jerry to where Jerry and Joe didn't go to the same school. Joe went to Hamilton Junior High School, where he worked on the Federalist, which was the school newspaper run by Jerry's cousin. And the name of the column was Jerry the Journalist. When Joe Shuster told Jerry's cousin that he was going to be moving into Jerry Siegel's neighborhood and go to Glenville High, Jerry's cousin said, "Be sure to look up my cousin Jerry. He's a great writer and you're a great illustrator. The two of you should get together." And they did. So when they met, Jerry began telling Joe about the characters he was writing. And Joe began to illustrate them. And they came up with all sorts of variations of what eventually became Superman. One night in June of 1934, after graduating that month, Jerry couldn't sleep. He was up all night and he began to write the story of what became the first issue of the DC Comics Superman Hero. And Joe was creating pictures of what he believed that the Superman character would look like. And he created all different types of characters. He even created villains, characters that were bad-looking characters. Eventually, he settled on a man in 1937 named Slam Bradley. That was a good character. All of the drawings for Superman were done by Joe over at his house on Parkwood Drive. But all of the writing was created in the bedroom on the third floor behind me at the top of this house on Kimberly Avenue. After Superman went into the comic books, but before he went on TV, he was in comic strips and he was on the radio. Superman was big on the radio in the 1940s. February 12, 1940 was the first radio broadcast of Superman. The program was on the radio until March 1, 1951, which is my second birthday and the birthday of Jerry Siegel's daughter. Bud Collier was the radio voice of Superman for 1,991 episodes on the radio. It was taken off the radio because 13 short feature films were shot in the summer of 1951, intended to be shown in theaters. It didn't happen. Only the first episode was shown in the theaters. The films were edited for television viewing, and that began on September 19, 1952. The first 3 years were shown on black and white TV only. If they were shown in color, few people had color TV, so it didn't really matter. The last Superman episode starring George Reeves on television was April 28, 1958. The second motion picture to be awarded 8 Academy Awards was shot in 1953. It was From Here to Eternity, and George Reeves had a part in that movie too. It was filmed in Hawaii, mostly at Schofield Barracks, where I was stationed in the Army from 1972 and 1973.
Monkey. Guys like you end up in the stockade sooner or later. Someday you walk in, I'll be waiting. I'll show you a couple of things.
George Reeves, in 1953, he also had another part in another excellent movie. It was called The Blue Gardenia, and he played Captain Sam Haynes. Raymond Burr also had a major role in The Blue Gardenia. In 1925 and 1926, Fritz Lang made a movie in Germany called Metropolis. Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster saw it at the theater, and that's where they got the idea to call the city where Superman and Clark Kent live, Metropolis.
Uh-oh, my roommate. Art class is over.
Oh, be a good girl and give me another minute, will you?
Well, I've heard that before. Sorry, no posing overtime.
How sincere were you in your column tonight about wanting to help the Blue Gardenia?
Very sincere.
And you don't think I should go to the police?
Not if you're the Blue Gardenia. You'd be black and blue before they got through with you.
Is that so?
Who is this?
Your good friend, Captain Haynes of the homicide detail.
Oh.
Only 4 years later, Raymond Burr became Perry Mason, who was television's most famous attorney. But because George's contract with ABC and the Superman series required him to begin shooting Superman on 30 days' notice, he could never sign a contract for an acting role that required him to be on a set or on location for more than 30 days. That eliminated him from getting any major roles or any bigger parts in movies.
Yeah. Who? Oh, Gary, I'm sorry I got tied up and I couldn't meet you, but... What?
The man that we knew as Superman, George Reeves, got his start in acting at the Pasadena Playhouse. His mother moved there from Iowa after she went through a succession of divorce and marriage. He was discovered at the Pasadena Playhouse, and in 1939 he had a small part in the opening sequence of Gone with the Wind. His character was Stuart Tarleton.
Why didn't you have every one of them taken already?
Oh,
honey, you can't do that to us.
How about if we tell you a secret?
Secret? Who by?
Well, you know Miss Melanie Hamilton from Atlanta?
Anthony Wilkes' cousin? Well, she's visiting the Wilkes' at 12.
Melanie Hamilton, that goody-goody. Who wants no secret about her?
Well, anyway, we heard. That is, they say that
Anthony Wilkes is going to marry her. You know the Wilkes' always marry their cousin.
Now, how do we get those points?
I never can make up my mind which of you two's the handsomest. I was awake all last night trying to figure it out.
The Academy Awards were first awarded in 1929. And in 1939, Gone with the Wind was the first movie to win 8 Academy Awards. In 1940, he was in a movie called Father is a Prince and Tear Gas Squad. 1941, Man at Large. 1942, Blue, White, and Perfect. 1943, So Proudly We Hail.
The engines have stopped.
Your life preserver. Where's your life preserver?
I left it in the cabin.
Here, take mine.
No.
Take it. Darling, before anything happens, tell me, do you love me?
No.
You're lying. You do love me.
Yes.
Well, say it then.
I love you. And then Superman, with one hand, held the streamliner, and with the other one, tore down the bridge and thus saved the life of his sweetheart.
Ngayon, hinawakan ni Superman ang streamliner ng isang kamay niya.
My translator.
La Charito.
She wants to know if Superman is so good, why isn't he here?
She would. Tell her he just landed with the Marines.
Here, call him Ken. Now you take care of your sister.
Take care of me, Stevie.
Is this Superman?
He'd better be. Go on your way, Toots. On your way!
In 1943, he also began acting with Hopalong Cassidy. Then he went into the service, the armed forces, when George made the movie So Proudly We Hail. The producer and director was Mark Sandrich. Mark had just come off another movie the year before, Holiday Inn. That was with Bing Crosby and Fred Astaire, and that's the movie where Bing Crosby introduced the song White Christmas. That became the biggest selling song of all time, and I can remember my father telling me that when they played that during Christmas time during the war, all the guys had tears in their eyes. Mark Sandrich had directed Ginger Rogers and Fred Astaire in 5 of their 9 movies together. And the biggest one, the best one, was in 1935 called Top Hat. So he was a first class, A-list, top shelf, first string producer and director. He made friends with George Reeves. And he told George, George, when you get out of the army, I'm going to make you a star. Well, that worked well. So George thought. But on March 4th, 1945, just before the war ended, Mark Sandrich had a massive heart attack while playing gin rummy with his wife in Hollywood and died.
When George returned from his tour of duty in World War II, he found that his friend Mark Sandrich had died. His plans are now going to change. He had to get some bit parts in movies. Along the way, George made friends. He made friends on his own, and from that, he was awarded the role of Superman in 1951.
What these two young men did in this house has an indelible impact upon us baby boomers, those of us born right after World War II. Whether Superman was in comic books, radio, or television, he was part of who we are today, and it can't be erased. The memories will never fade. For this man who I like to call Smiling George, because he was always smiling, his life had a lot of twists and turns. I thought he was doing well as Superman, and as kids growing up, we loved him. We loved the way he acted, we loved the way he appeared, we loved the way he treated everybody on and off camera. He seemed to really be enjoying himself, although we didn't know it, we just knew Superman. George's life had many different chapters, and we're going to take a trip out to 1579 Benedict Canyon Drive near Los Angeles. This is the final chapter, and it's the saddest chapter in the life of the man that we knew as Superman.
Let's go visit the home where George Reeves
died. This is the house of 1579 Benedict Canyon Drive, where Superman died on June 16, 1959. We're told that he shot himself. Nobody really believes that because there was no gunpowder on his head. There was no fingerprint found on the murder weapon, a 30 caliber German Luger. George Reeves was drunk that night. He had a blood alcohol of 0.27. I'm not sure if he was sober enough to even pull the trigger. But there was somebody upstairs in the bedroom. Now, the bedroom that he died in is not the front bedroom. George Reeves was shot to death in the upstairs bedroom in the back of the house. In this house, George Reeves, the only Superman that we knew as kids growing up in Cleveland, Ohio, in this house, George Reeves' life came to an end. One gunshot wound to the head. The story comes from so many different directions as to how it happened, whether or not it was a suicide or whether it was a murder. The evidence is convoluted because there was never a police investigation. The people who were in the house at the time were never questioned by the police, never taken to the police station, never interrogated. They never gave any kind of testimony. The lady who was with him up in the bedroom at the time he supposedly committed suicide, her name was Lenore Lemon. She was George's fiancée. She immediately left Los Angeles and went back to New York and never came back to give any testimony or any evidence. The gun, the 30 caliber Luger that was used to kill George, had no fingerprints. There were no powder burns on George's head. And there was no gunpowder residue on George's hand. And the only reason it's ruled a suicide is because that's what the police wrote on their police report. And two autopsies were done. One said suicide based upon who knows what. And the other one said inconclusive. George's mother, Helen, had a second autopsy performed because she didn't believe the first one. She wanted there to be some determination that George did not commit suicide. That second autopsy ruled that the death was undetermined. The bottom line is, and history can't be changed after 60 years, Superman died in this house. There were 104 episodes of Superman. Superman went off the air in the spring of 1958. There's not going to be another season beginning in September of 58, but it was picked up in 1959 for another season. 26 episodes were committed. Many people say that George was distraught because he had to live in that monkey suit for the rest of his life, as he called it.
I was a little girl that lived up the street. And
you lived up the street?
Yeah, we lived up the street, and when the bus would pass here, we all knew Superman lived here.
Now, I was 10 years old when it occurred.
Uh-huh.
And we couldn't believe that this guy, Superman, actually died. So it was a shock to a 10-year-old kid who actually believed that bullets bounced off his chest and he could fly. Because we all dreamt about the same heaven, the same powers. But you lived up the street from this guy. And you watched him.
Everybody knew. All the kids knew. I don't know how old I was. I think I was in the third grade.
Third plus five, you were 8 years old. So I'm 70, you're 68 years old. I'm sorry.
Yeah. So we all knew this was Superman.
Did you ever meet him?
No.
Did you ever see him?
No.
Oh, okay.
No. You watch him? Really, this house is not haunted.
There's no real determination as to how Superman died. We only know he died by a gunshot wound, one wound to the head. Doesn't sound like a suicide to me. It sounds like somebody else pulled the trigger. Upstairs with him at the time was Lenore Lemon. That was his girlfriend. Superman was dating another woman, but she was married. He was going to marry, that was his fiancée, Lenore Lemon. Tony Maddox's girlfriend, who was married to Eddie Maddox, who was the general manager of MGM Studios, she was allowed to date Superman because her husband had an open relationship with her and it was okay for them. But there were a lot of hard feelings in the whole triangle of this love affair. When Lenore Lemon came down from the upstairs, she told everybody in this small gathering in Superman's living room, right inside here, tell everybody I was down here. It took them almost an hour to get the police to respond. Nobody called the police for 45 minutes. For some reason, the police never took it seriously. The police refused to make a thorough investigation for whatever reason they had. I'm told that there were a lot of connections and the investigation was only half-hearted. That appears to be the way it was. But with all of that, we'll never know the truth of how Superman, George Reeves, died in this house. were watching him on TV, black and white TV, but we were glued to that set when Superman was on. And we knew when the bad guys were going to fire those bullets at his chest, boom, they'd just bounce off. It was funny. We watched it. We cheered for Superman every time. But there was no cheering for Superman on this night, June 16th, 1959. He filmed a commercial in this house at one time. It was a commercial for breakfast cereal. He filmed it in this kitchen, and he even showed the audience how he would get into his bed the night before, waking up in the morning, needing to feel energized, revitalized, and strong enough to take on the tasks of the day. As George Reeves, though, there was no flying, there was no bullets bouncing off his chest. It didn't matter. If we ate the same cereal that George Reeves ate, we would be Superman.
Hello there. This is George Reeves, your candid reporter for Kellogg's. You know, the greatest name in cereals. And now, we'd like to take you into the home of our guest star. Why, it's me. Perhaps you know me better as Superman or Clark Kent, who's actually taking these pictures, probably. That's my little schnauzer pal. Oh, not in the mouth, Sam. He's reminding me it's time for breakfast. Here we go. Kellogg's cornflakes do go fast and are easy to run out of. But I always keep a spare. I do like a heaping bowl of Kellogg's cornflakes to start my day. And you know, they're my favorite. Kellogg's cornflakes are packaged sunshine, fresh, crispy and flavorful flakes from corn which lives with the sun longer than any other grain. Chock full of vitamins, and I do like them truly, as you can see. Very good. Believe me, Kellogg's cornflakes are the best things I know for super muscle building energy. And I'm strong for them. In fact, I'm ready for action right now. You see, judo was my hobby, and that's my judo outfit. Well, we'll do a few one-arm push-ups. And then, we're ready for a series of judo falls. In judo, these are called number five falls. Over, and over, and over once again. Which is very easy with a little know-how and a lot of energy. And muscle. What is that? Well, now, there is the real muscle builder, Kellogg's cornflakes. Thank you for visiting with us. And now, I do hope I'll see you soon.
In the adventures of Superman. What are you trying to do? Become a Superman?